You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net.
Good morning. I want to call to order the Joint Appropriations Committee. You know, we have sort of a tradition we've started that we always start with the Pledge of Allegiance. So I'm going to ask you to all stand and we'll go around the room. And so, Senator Kobeck, you want to lead us?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you so very much. I want to welcome those of you that are listening online and those of you that are present in the room. We appreciate today we've got a full calendar. We will be starting out with the school and public lands, the PUC. We are going to have to make a modification because there's a conflict. So we are going to move the treasurer to this afternoon after the governor's office budget. So they have been notified. They will come this afternoon, so we will conclude by 11 o'clock. I understand the House has a meeting, so we'll accommodate for them today. Just a reminder for those that are speaking to please come. Always identify yourself, even when questions are asked, so our home audience knows who is responding, and you need to sign in. And I will ask you all to silence your cell phones. With that, I will ask the Secretary to take the roll.
Representative Otten. Representative Kasson.
Here.
Representative Mills.
Here.
Senator Wick.
Here.
Representative Duba.
Absent, excused.
Senator Foster.
Here.
Senator Johnson.
Here.
Representative Crow.
Here.
Senator Maher.
Here.
Representative Carr.
Here.
Senator Koth. Representative Koth, might.
Here.
Senator Kobeck.
Here.
Senator Boland.
Here.
Senator Wink.
Here.
Representative Van Huysen.
Here.
Senator Breitling.
Here.
Representative Derby.
Here.
Senator Hunoff.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Representative Duba just walked in.
Thank you.
Thank you. With that, we have pages. I'm going to ask you to go to the desk there. Please say who you are, where you go to school.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dustin Hermanson. I'm from Aberdeen. My future plans are I go to school at Aberdeen Central High School. I'm a senior. My future plans are to attend the United States Air Force Academy.
I'm Cheyenne Hunnewell. I go to Bonhomme, and my future plans is to go to the University of Sioux Falls and double major in criminal justice and psychology.
Thank you very much, and we'll look to you to assist us during our meeting. Thank you again. You know, one thing we didn't do that yesterday that I think for all of us, so we know, we all have interns, both the Republicans and the Democrats. So I think just to introduce the interns that are here so we can say who they are and where they're going to school and what their futures are. So do we have any in here?
Yeah.
All right.
Can any of them come up to the mic?
Yes, they can come up to the mic. We'll start here, if that's okay, Representative Duba.
Well, hi, everyone. My name's Taylor Van Emmerich. I am from T, South Dakota originally. Otherwise, I go to the University of South Dakota. I am studying economics and political science down there, and it's just been a great opportunity to be working with all of you.
Hello, my name's Quinn Borman. I'm originally from Parkston, South Dakota. I'm attending the University of South Dakota with a dual major in political science and economics. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Connor Hansen. I'm originally from Aberdeen. I'm a senior at Augustana University, and we're going to go 3 for 3 here. I am also studying economics and political science. Thank you.
Very good. We'll look for all of you in the future of the legislature. Thank you. All right. Mr. Co-Chair, do you have anything?
No, Madam Chair.
All right, then we will get started. And we welcome to the podium the commissioner for the school and public lands. New position, same individual. So welcome.
Good morning, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Brock Greenfield. I'm the new commissioner of school and public lands. I guess I got sworn in 4 days ago. I've been on the job for 2 days. It's a pleasure to be in front of you. You know, every so often I know somebody who comes before us as a page or an intern, and I do want to mention, because some of you would know this person, Dustin Hermanson. You won't know his parents, but his dad was my next-door neighbor. I was his RA in college, and his mother is a Gassman girl from down in Canova, and they were both college athletes and good people. The Gassman name is familiar to some of us because Dave, in addition to being one of the two greatest pitchers, perhaps the greatest in South Dakota amateur baseball history, he was also a legislator for a number of years. And Dustin, he's got a lively arm. I'm not going to say he throws 95 like Grandpa did, but Dave Gassman was very feared amongst the amateur baseball ranks for a number of years. So I just wanted to mention that. I got to coach against him last year, and he's a good young talent. I'll ask my deputy to come up here and take a seat next to me. I'd like to introduce you to Justin Nagel. Justin has been around the ranks of state government for a number of years, about a decade and a half. He's worked for most recently the Department of Revenue. Prior to that, he had worked for Bureau of Finance and Management and then the Board of Regents. Back on May 9th, Jared Johnson and Ryan Bruner, they had introduced us back in April. And Jared made the decision to bring him on as the deputy commissioner on May 9th. So he's got 8 months and 2 days, 3 days under his belt. 2 days. And I am going to be deferring a lot of the time here in front of you today to him because he has been a quick study and he's done a very good job of boning up on all things that are school and public lands. There's a familiar face behind me. Our surface agent is Mike Corneliuson. He's the damn man, yeah. He's just getting his feet wet. He's only been on the job 43 years. Our investment officer is Renee Knapp. She's waving back there. Our administrative assistant is Taylin Bradford. She's an Oneida grad, a Sully Buttes grad. And Trayton Cost-Hilmer is our oil, gas, and mineral agent. We've vacated our office. We will have Taylin go back and hold down the fort as we get started. But the rest of us will be around for questions as they arise and what have you. I would note this committee is obviously legendary, often held as the most charming and best looking committee, and it is a pleasure to be
point of order. Point of order.
It is a pleasure to be in front of you today. I'm going to turn things over to Justin. We have 30 slides, down from 39 last year, but he's going to go through them, and we will try again to answer any questions as they arise. I assume that you will present questions as we go as opposed to at the end. Okay, so we'll just allow it to be a fluid conversation. Thank you.
Good morning, Madam Chair and esteemed committee members. My name is Justin Nagel, Deputy Commissioner for the Office of School and Public Lands. Thank you for the opportunity to give you an overview and financial highlights of our office. We begin with a slide that illustrates how the Office of School and Public Lands can be broken down into four focused areas, which we will go into more detail on as we progress with this presentation. These four areas are: we manage over 750,000 acres of state trust land that generates over $12 million in payout to the South Dakota schools, K-12 school districts in each of the last 2 years. Through the South Dakota Investment Council, the Office of School and Public Lands is custodian of a permanent trust fund with a fair market value of $371 million at June 30, 2022. We manage 5 million mineral acres for lease that returned almost $1 million to our education system in 2022. And lastly, something a lot of people don't know about us, but the Office of School and Public Lands acts as the real estate agent for the state for any land sales or land acquisitions. We will touch more on this near the end of the presentation. A little background about the Office of School and Public Lands. Prior to becoming a state in 1869, the United States President Ulysses S. Grant appointed General William Henry Harrison Beadle as a land surveyor for the state of South Dakota, for the Dakota Territory. General Beadle was well aware of a need for an economic base and revenue stream for public education. Because the original eastern states had no public land to generate revenue for education, General Beadle insisted on setting aside land in new states for that very purpose. When South Dakota became a state in 1889, the federal government granted the state over 3.5 million acres of land. The state of South Dakota has over 1,000 full and partial townships within its borders. A township consists of 36 one-mile by one-mile sections. Based on General Beadle's vision, sections 16 and 36 were carved out of every township for the intent of providing a revenue source for public education. These set-aside lands became known as common school lands. General Beadle is honored to this day as the only statue in our state capitol near the second floor's east stairwell. Because many of the townships in eastern South Dakota were already settled in sections 16 and 36 were no longer available as public lands, the federal government provided replacement property known as indemnity lands to make up for the shortage of availability of land in the eastern part of the state. As such, the vast majority of land managed by the Office of School and Public Lands is in the northwest corner of the state, in Harding, Perkins, and Butte counties, as these lands were largely uninhabited at the time. To manage the newly created state's common school and indemnity lands, the state constitution established the Office of School and Public Lands. In recent years, the office has returned $10 to $12 million to the South Dakota school districts and endowed institutions through revenue generating activities such as livestock grazing leases, oil and gas exploration, and wind turbine electric energy creation.
And I'm just going to interject. The slide is correct. There was a misspeak, but it was the reference to 1889 is correct. I know that it was stated 1869, but the slide was correct.
This is a map of South Dakota. Scone Public Lands are shown in this map in blue. As you can see, the vast majority of lands managed by this office are in the northwest corner of the state.
And I would also interject, we have the technology in our office to zoom in, and we can provide anybody with a closer look at those lands. I know as you look at that, it's pretty far away, zoomed out, but you will notice the concentration of those school and public lands out in the northwest corner, as well as in a few other areas. But as we zoom in on our technology, if you have any questions, we can certainly talk about particular tracks.
Okay, here we go. Attached is a close-up of Butte County showing several townships where sections 16 and 36 were available and set aside by the federal government at statehood, circled in red. If the state had been completely unsettled, this is how every township section in the state would look like with respect to common school lands. The majority of state land in this office manages generates revenue through our surface division and subsequent land leases. Our largest source of revenue is from grazing leases. The public auctions are held on a county-by-county basis every year at the respective courthouses. These terms are one five-year period followed by an optional five-year period. Lessees are responsible for paying the county property tax on the land they lease. Additionally, with the approval of this office, lessees are able to construct and own improvements on the leased land and share the cost of controlling noxious weeds and pests with us. As shown by the graph, the revenue from surface leases has gone up along with the price of land for the last several years, creating $8.2 million in revenue in fiscal year 2022. Of the 760,000 acres managed by this office, 80% of the lands are classified as common school lands benefiting K-12 education across the state. SDSU is number two on the list. SDSU received more endowed land than the state's other universities because of the Morrill Act of 1862, establishing land grants for state's agricultural schools. The remaining 15% is split up between the state's other universities and special schools.
Can I just stop you? Will you go back to that last slide? I'm sorry. Okay, so surface revenue, so they have gone up in 2018, but now we're seeing a decline?
A little decline in the last couple of years, that's correct.
What's the contributing factor to that?
I believe it's smaller, less lease amounts, generating less lease amounts from surface leases, as well as the investment council's returns have gone down slightly.
Okay, all right, thank you.
Here we go. Slide 11 provides an overview of wind energy projects on state lands. In FY 2021, School and Public Lands enrolled the first of the state's acreage into five separate wind farms. In FY 22, wind energy revenue totaled nearly $120,000. The U.S. Department of Energy contacted our office in December regarding a proposed new wind farm near Phillips, South Dakota, that would connect with a WAPA transmission line there. The office has expressed an interest in participating in this project, although we did not manage a lot of acreage in that area. Slide 12 provides a summary of our oil and gas exploration and production on state lands in FY 2022. Of the state's 5.2 million mineral acres, just 46,651 of those are leased acres. In FY 2022, the office received royalty payments totaling just over $1.5 million.
Madam Chair, at this point, I would interject. I was looking at those numbers last week, and I was wondering why the big discrepancy. So I contacted former Commissioner Ryan Bruner, and he says, well, understand that some of those acres are in places where it's not beneficial to somebody to want to lease them. He said, for example, there are some right in the heart of downtown Sioux Falls. And so the 46,000 are those acres that can be utilized for exploration, et cetera, but some of those acres are not accessible.
Senator Boland.
Thank you. I notice where it says leased mineral acres, I think just prior to the slide that's up there now. One's in North Dakota, and one, some are North Dakota, some in Wyoming. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, I asked the question of that of former Commissioner Bruno myself. And the mineral acres are actually underground versus surface acres. And so some of the wells are right near the border. And so they are, you get credit for Slope County, North Dakota, and Weston County, Wyoming.
Okay. That's enough. Thank you.
Yep.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you, Commissioner. You just mentioned that there is some school and public land in downtown Sioux Falls.
The mineral rights.
So they're underneath private building?
Madam Chair, thank you, Mr. Wick, Senator. And that was the answer that was given to me by the former commissioner that, you know, we, when land transactions take place, we maintain the mineral rights, and so some of those mineral rights are in inopportune locations, such as Sioux Falls, or other, you know, other acres that are inaccessible. So he just gave me a couple of different examples,
so
and I thought I'd mention that.
Madam Chair.
Senator Maher.
Can I give a history lesson here? So in 1920, the school and public lands had a lot of excess revenue. So they went out there and they started giving farm loans out. They started lending money. Then in the 1930s, everybody went broke. And so the state took that land, or took the land back, but they liquidated that land, but they kept the mineral interest. So there's all these fractionated in mineral interests all across the state because of those transactions that happened in the 20s, where the land was lost, but the state retained the mineral interests. So.
Thank you. There is some land just up on North Cliff Avenue in Sioux Falls. That's probably, nobody seems to want it, but you guys are in control of that, and then there may be some mineral rights on that particular piece of property, but it is up on the hill way up on North Cliff Avenue.
Senator Wink.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I guess as well as we're talking about land transactions and so on, could you answer a question for me? We have used to have a section of public school land on the ranch that I'm on now, and now it's but they used to be able to sell some of that land back to the private property owner that surrounded it, and that stopped at some point, but I'm not sure what year. Would anybody know the year that is and why they did that?
That was an exchange. Mike Cornelius and Land Agent, South Dakota School and Public Lands. That was a facilitated land exchange program that ended when Bryce Healy was the former commissioner. At the end of his term, legislative audit said that there had to be some corrections as far as accountability. Everything came out all right, but part of it was just the way it was cash drawered until we used the funds. So we can still do exchanges, but we can't do facilitated exchanges, and that's how some of those whole sections was exchanged out. Now, that could possibly be revived, but it has been viewed that they do not want the South Dakota state competing or getting involved in a very big way with the real estate markets in South Dakota, I mean, the state itself. So there is that concern. There is a way to do exchanges on a one-to-one basis with RLC and the office, but it has to be appraised. And there is a little bit of that, and then we can take on land sales in small portions. So we sold some remnant parcels, parcels that are old railroad right-of-ways, and small acreages that once it's appraised, it's advertised, and it can be sold at auction. But the most positive I ever heard was from the lessees is that they had a chance to acquire land that they at least probably for or probably a century in some cases. Mm-hmm. But they can't. They could still do a one-to-one exchange, but not a facilitated land exchange.
Thank you.
That's more of an answer, maybe.
No, thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
Yep.
Go on. Yeah. All right, back to the presentation. Slide 13 shows the price of oil, American oil, for the last 10 years. As you can see, if the price of oil fell to nearly zero in 2020 at the height of the pandemic and rebounded over $100 a barrel shortly before Russia invaded the Ukraine, the break-even for oil producers is generally considered to be around $50 per barrel. This slide displays our oil and gas royalties over the last 10 years. As you can see, royalties have remained steady for the last 6 years, averaging about $1.5 million a year. We'll now discuss the permanent trust fund managed by the South Dakota Investment Council. The permanent fund was established at statehood with the intent of providing a continuous revenue stream for public education. Prior to the year 2001, the growth of the state's permanent fund was based solely on land sales, 50% of mineral revenues, and capital gains. In the 2000 general election, voters changed the state's constitution to allow more flexibility with respect to how the permanent funds may be invested in order to capture more growth. As you can see from this slide, for the 26 years from 1974 to the year 2000, the permanent fund maintained a balance between $65 and $130 million. Since the change in constitution went into effect in 2001, the permanent fund has grown from $130 million to $371 million as of 6/30/2022. Just as we saw in the payout slides, the largest share of the permanent fund resides with K-12 schools, and with a balance of $184 million. We report a permanent fund balance of $231 million here on this slide versus $371 million on the previous slide. The difference between these figures can be attributed to the fair market value of securities that the South Dakota Investment Council manages on our behalf. These values are viewed as unrealized gains in the financial reporting arena. Slide 18 shows how the apportionment payout to the public schools and universities is processed. There were no land sales in FY22, but if there were, the entire amount would be passed to the trust fund balance, whereas oil and gas royalties are broken out 50-50, with one half going to the permanent fund and the other half towards school apportionment. And surface lease revenues are distributed in their entirety as part of the school apportionment every year. In 2022, South Dakota School and Public Lands paid out over $12 million to the state's public school districts, endowed universities, and special schools.
And I would interject, and I know I stop at our own peril, because a lot of times when I interject or somebody else does, it prompts some questions. But I would just, if you bounce back to that slide, I would note that the permanent trust fund cannot be violated. It can only grow. We can utilize the investment earnings off that trust fund, but it remains inviolate. So I wanted to point that out.
Representative Carr.
Thank you. I was looking at the slide and I was trying to trace some of your numbers back. So you got the 8.092, that's from oil and minerals revenue?
That's correct.
And then the 8.2 is from land leasing?
That's correct, surface leases.
Right, so I was just, you know, I'm going back to, I think slide 10, is that right? The 8.092, isn't this from land leases? I was just trying to connect the dots.
Trying to get back slide. Which slide did you say we were looking at here?
Go to 10.
I don't have numbers on these slides, but is this?
Nope, keep going forward one. One more. There you go. So is this land lease revenue? Is that what this is a breakout of?
From lease revenue, I believe so, yes.
But that's the 8.092 there, is the total.
Okay, that's a mistake I made on this worksheet. I'm sorry about that. Those numbers should be flip-flopped. The 8.2 should be in the oil and gas, and the 8.092 should be down in the surface lease. That's a great catch.
Okay, I was just trying to follow along here.
No, I apologize.
With the flow chart. Thank you.
I own that.
We will. We'll update that and provide that to staff. Thank you.
I have a question. You said there were no land sales this past year?
I believe so. That's correct.
Are there some parcels that are sitting there for sale that haven't been? I'm thinking over the course, that's the first time I haven't heard we had not had land sales.
As I started in May, we haven't had any land sales since I've been on board, and I don't believe there were any prior to, but I'd love to ask our land agent, Mike Cornelison.
Mike Cornelison, land agent, school and public lands. There are two tracts of land, one in Tripp County and there's another one in Brown County that we have appraisals on. And we can sell those since they've been appraised. We just have to have a board of appraisal meeting, which is different than an actual appraisal. And then we advertise and we can sell those. And there's people interested in buying those, but they're just small tracts. We do have the right, though, to sell land yet, but we haven't sold land for probably getting on to 24, 5 years, because part of the steam for land sales was people acquiring land, and when we had the facilitated land exchange, that took a lot of the interest out of the land sale portion, because they could still buy it through a facilitated land exchange. But without having that facilitated land exchange, there's a lot of people that would like to buy land. We have a lot of inquiries as to buying land. We have, I think, a 3-4% above the average interest rate that we can lock in on contracts for deed. They have to pay 30% down. Then we carry the balance on contract for 20 years. So, I mean, there's some pretty great features. The biggest thing is we used to do in-house appraisals, and now we have to hire appraisals. So that costs quite a bit of money. And then in the case of advertising, we have budget for that. That's not a problem. Yes?
Just one other question. Did we sell some property at Redfield when we were downsizing? Did some of that?
We did.
And is that all that was thought to be sold or was projected to be sold? Has that been?
Not in entirety, no.
Okay.
There's still property at Redfield that's human services property, yeah.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So I heard you say it's been like 22 years since you sold land. So help me out with the Star Academy. Why aren't you counting that?
Okay. The property we did sell was property that was department lands. That in particular, Star Academy, was corrections. But I mean, we end up selling property for Board of Regents if directed.
Okay.
For others.
All set? Thank you, Mike.
Incidentally, that question is one that I would have raised as well. And, you know, you get the baptism of fire, so to speak, and start learning, okay, well, this is that lane. That's a, you know, piece of corrections land. So, well, we're the agent that sells that, we're the office that serves that role. Those dollars don't flow through these funds.
That raises a question. Madam Chair, the question is, do you get a commission off of doing that work for those other agencies?
Mike Cornelius and land agent, school and public lands. We were paid for some of the work we did. The advertising was able to be covered. Some of the costs associated, appraisals can be part of it as well. But as far as they reimbursing us for our time, no, that isn't in the mix.
Senator Johnson.
Thank you. So since you're the real estate agent for your terms for the state, when you do sell land that is school and public lands, do you ever go out and acquire land, or do you just sell and that's done, you step away? Or have we purchased anything as a state? I'm going to ask the dam man. I thought you were the dam man.
He's our land agent, expert.
Mike Cornelison, land agent. Well, I am a dam man. And I'm proud to say that. But in the realm of the real estate and buying land, we bought the property with an option to purchase for Department of Health years ago with an option to purchase, and now we have the health lab up there. But that was for as agency directed. In the facilitated land exchange, that was a cash drawer situation where the funds were not held in our office. They were held outside our office. It was Game Fish and Parks Foundation held the funds. And then we used those funds later to buy land. And we did. We had to have the land appraised, and we purchased land because we had a cash drawer to reach into to buy the land. If we do a land sale, all the initial proceeds go into the permanent fund, and as we receive, you know, interest and income that's applied, that the permanent fund gets any income part of it, interest is distributed differently. But yes, we have, you know, but normally we don't go out and buy property just for the fact that we've got quite a few acres and we haven't pursued that. And we don't have money anyway to do that with it.
Paul? Could you explain for me what you mean by facilitated exchange? What does that terminology mean?
Well, it's sort of, facilitate would be a creative way of enhancing exchanges. A one-on-one exchange is somewhat limited on the ability to trade with immediate trade with a smaller acreage. We did do some property for the South Dakota State Fair. They identified property, it had to be appraised. There again, it wasn't for our office, but it was for the state fair. Then we found some trust lands that could be exchanged for in a small way, and those monies that we received from those were used to acquire the land for the state fair. Although we own the land, state fair rents it. So those are small deals, but in a facilitated land exchange, we are able to do bigger trades, and we can just reach out and buy a property if we think it has amenities to enhance income. A lot of times we look for property that would actually not just be grazing land, but also have farming, agricultural lands with it, may have good attributes for other endeavors that would generate income. In other states, they use that process to buy land for future shopping malls and retirement communities in other states, not here, but it is a practice. I don't know if I've answered your question, though, but.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And before we move on, I'm just still hung up a little bit on your flow chart. Can we go back to that? Thank you. And we already established that the numbers you said were kind of flip-flopped. 8.2 should be in the top bubble, and the 8.092 should be in the bottom bubble for land and lease?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. Last year, your oil and mineral was like 1.15 in revenue, million. And now you're showing 8.23. So I'm just, where's the additional 7 million of revenue coming from? And also, I'm just going to hearken back. I haven't heard that word here since Senator Greenfield was in Appropriations. But anyhow, to your slide that says that the royalties were 22 for mineral, oil, and gas, or 1.5. So I'm just curious what the other remainder is.
I worked through these slides relatively quickly for the last 4 days. We I wasn't aware that our hearing was this week, so I put these together quickly with information that Ryan used last year that I put together and updated this year. I would love to get back to you, Representative Carr, with the information on how those numbers are calculated, because it relates to our annual report and some of the calculations. But I will be able to show you how I arrived at that. But can I get back to you about that? Because I don't have it in front of me.
Yeah, follow up, please. Thank you. And I guess I'm just curious if not only those numbers should be flipped, but if that one number is completely wrong, if it should be the 1.5, or if there is some massive surge of revenue that we haven't identified yet.
Well, the payout is correct, the $12.2 million to the K through 12 schools and the endowed universities and institutions. Okay. So I believe that those figures are correct. I'll have to get back to you, though, as far as how that 8.2 million is in the oil and gas. I'm not sure off the top of my head here. Because I do know the 12.2 million payout is accurate.
Okay. Because I said, you know, like I said, last year, I think looking back, it was more the 1.12 is in that bubble.
Yep, understood.
Thank you.
Yep.
Another question, Representative Colton.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Question, help me understand, the land that is owned, are there real estate taxes?
Yes, there are. We have an in-lieu tax on land that's leased. We don't pay tax, but if we lease it, the lessee has to pay tax. And that was a change that was brought on. We used to have a short grass bill years and years ago where they'd have to give money to try and compensate counties that weren't getting revenue. This way now, they get revenue just like off any other lands if it's leased. And so, yes, there is income coming off it. Just the same as if you owned it, you'd be paying tax on it in addition to the lease. Yes.
Okay, you can continue on.
Thank you. Representative Carr, I see where my mistake is on this flow chart slide. You're right that oil and gas should be about $1.5 million. If you look above where the permanent trust fund is, there's interest in dividends of $7.1 million that should be coupled with that oil and gas figure to reach that 8.0 number that would then equal the payout. So I apologize. Again, I put this together hastily and made a couple of mistakes. Thank you for pointing it out.
Madam Chair, I'll just interject at this point. A good question relative to the property taxes due, and I've had conversations with different people as to you know their thoughts on that, and they said we're deriving a benefit from the state property, and therefore we should contribute at the local level. If not, especially in Harding and Perkins and Butte counties, there'd be a real shift of tax burdens. But there's a situation that I came across a few years ago. This was one of the things that really piqued my interest in what goes on within this office. There's a gentleman from my neck of the woods who had purchased a bit of property just outside Doland where I grew up. And as he went in and filed for a land patent, he found out that he didn't own it free and clear. There had been four transactions that had taken place, but what had ultimately spurred this confusion was the railroad defaulted. They didn't pay their taxes that were due to Spink County, and Spink County said, well, they owe us taxes, and since they haven't paid for a number of years, we're seizing the property and selling it at public auction. They sold it at public auction, but it wasn't theirs to sell. It was still the state. And there had been four transactions, as I understand, that had taken place. The only recourse would have been for him to go back on the person that had sold to him and that person to go back on the previous owner and so on and so forth till you got back to the county. In the end, there weren't a bunch of lawsuits. They made it work. The gentleman was still out some money, but he landed in a spot where he was happy. But you can see where there would be some confusion, especially as auditors, as there's turnover within counties and whatnot. They don't always know the lay of the land. And I think that's one of the things that will be a burden on our office, is to make sure that everybody knows if there is a situation that arises relative to failure to pay property taxes, we're going to have to work through that and not allow it to devolve to a situation like I just outlined.
All right, we'll be back to the presentation. Slide 19 shows the dollars that have been paid out to the K-12 school districts for the last, since 2013. The payout to K-12 schools has been at or above $10 million since 2017. The payout dipped the last couple of years because interest rates were at historic lows in 2020 and 2021. With interest rates rising since last June, we expect to see a higher payout in 2023. Slides 20 and 21, the next two slides display FY22 apportionment to the universities and endowed institutions. As you could probably guess, SDSU received the largest apportionment of the bunch, as we manage more lands and assets for SDSU than we do the others. This next slide is with respect to the Broome Superfund Giltedge Mine site, because the federal spending bill that was signed by President Biden last month includes sale of 266 acres of Forest Service land to the state of South Dakota. You can identify those lands in the green on the map there within the Superfund site. Danner will be purchasing those lands, and we will be acting as the real estate agent for the state with respect to those lands, but Danner will administer the cleanup of the Superfund site. And our last slides, we're going to spend some time talking about dams, and we've got our dam man here. The final slides of our presentation, we'll look at and provide updates to the special appropriations that were done in FY20 and FY21 for the Elm Lake Dam and Richmond Dam, both in Brown County, South Dakota. As you can see from this slide, in 2020, the flooding in Brown County caused significant damage to the Elm Lake spillway. Senate Bill 47 in 2021 provided $9 million to replace the spillway at Elm Lake. The architectural and engineering work concluded in 2021, and the construction project began in the winter of 2021 and 2022 to replace the spillway at Elm Lake Dam. Presently, the Office of the State Engineer is inspecting that work for acceptance. Here's a few more photos of the construction process to replace the spillway at Elm Lake. Richmond Dam. Much like Elm Lake Dam, Richmond Dam suffered damages due to the 2020-2021 flooding and was in dire need of repair. 2022 Senate Bill 52 appropriated $6.5 million to inspect the dam and provide the repairs and maintenance. The architectural and engineering inspection and testing portion of the Richmond Dam site is wrapping up as we speak, and we expect to be hearing proposals for the construction work by the end of this month. This slide shows the immediate impacted area of a Richmond Dam breach. There's both residential and commercial sites that would be affected by that.
And Madam Chair, members of the committee, at this point, I just want to interject. Back probably 3 or 4 months ago, a number of folks went down to Wagner, and I was asked to join them. I drove down from Clark that morning, and I got to see the Wagner Dam, and that's a medium hazard dam, but it has a real benefit to the community. Ryan Bruner was there crawling around in places where I probably couldn't even fit and taking pictures. I have a couple pictures. What Ryan said relative to 2 years ago is that there's been substantial deterioration of that structure. I just want to put it on your radar. That's obviously just outside of Wagner. We'll call it in the city. It probably is within the city limits, but that's in Charles Mix County. There's also Bednar Dam out in Zeebach County that are very high on our list of priorities. And as session unfolds, I just, again, want to put it on your radar. If there is a discussion about potential for one-time dollars, we'd like to be part of that conversation, because as you well know from the discussion about Elm Lake Dam and Richmond Dam and what have you, some of these serve great purpose to their communities. Some of these pose strong potential for loss of life and land and livestock, what have you. They do need attention, and we'd like to get those things taken care of as soon as possible. So just want to put it on your radar. And I would note that one of the pictures that I took that I could show you on my phone, I don't have it on the slides. There was a crack, a space, that was very easy to see through between two different concrete slats. And again, the dam down there at Wagner is one that I'm familiar with and is certainly in need. And then, as I said, Bednar is one that's on our office's radar as well.
Senator Boland.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you. The ones that you referenced, were those all built in the 1930s?
Yes, sir. They were CCA and WPA projects during the Depression era.
Okay. And then one follow-up question. Do you, with of the facilities, these dams that you are responsible for, are there any that you would look at to say this should be, you know, we should remove it and just let the water run free? Do we have any on a potential list that would no longer be maintained and would be eliminated, at least at the present time?
Now you are the dam. Mike Cornelison, land agent. School and Public Lands. It's not on. Okay. Mike Cornelison, land agent, South Dakota School and Public Lands. There are dams. We have disposed of dams back to the property owners. They, of course, are not probably the same as back in, as in 33, but we have, for the most part, easements. So if it's in a condition that we can transfer it, we do a lot of times do that if there's interest in doing that. We cannot transfer something that's in a high hazard condition. And then some of the dams, they're actually associated with game production areas. And so we might still want to retain the dam, but not at a capacity that it poses even a very low hazard. You know, they can be used for waterfowl habitat, not a fishery habitat. But yes, we can, and we have identified some. Latham was gotten rid of in Falk County last year. The colony wanted it up there. They wanted to irrigate with it. It has enough silt and debris in it, and it is not close. Was not close enough for hunting and fishing. It wasn't being utilized for that. So we did eventually get that taken off the books. We quit claimed our interest in that, and now the colony has it. It was in sufficient condition, though, that we could transfer it. And then we have others where people are interested in getting rid of them and are picking them up, but they have to have some follow-through on it. You know, they have to continue to want to pursue it. But we are willing to get rid of dams that don't provide any fishing or hunting access anymore. And we actually find some every so often that we didn't even know about. They can be a weir, which is just a cement structure in the middle of the river. It can be a small dam that we weren't aware of. So the Works Projects Administration, or the CCC camps that went along with that, you know, they did all those projects, and they had to have federal monies to do it, but the states and the local communities, and a lot of times the state picked up the ownership. So, you know, we're in a position, we can get rid of those if someone really wants to, and if they don't, we first have to run it up the flagpole to see if Game and Fish or some other entity feels strongly about it.
And if I could just follow up briefly, and I think my main reason for asking that question is that, you know, we have quite a few of these, it's my understanding, and at some point in time, some of them, I think, do need to just be eliminated. We have to move towards that to other than the fact, rather than have this ongoing financial responsibility for projects that were built simply to put people to work 75, 80, 90 years ago, there needs to be some type of an evaluation of which ones need to be maintained and which ones need to be eliminated. That's all I got to say. Thank you.
I would have to say your feelings are what the feelings are of a lot of people that I visit with on them. Most of the funds that we do utilize, that we do get, they're because for a couple reasons. They're either high hazard dams, or they present a hazard, and or there's a community like Wagner or someone else that wants to probably pick up 75% of the repair costs if they can just get us to on board to help them. You know, when we find people in areas where there are dams, but the majority of the 100 state-owned dams, we're not spending money on them. Yes, sir.
We'll get back to the presentation, which brings us to the final slide of our presentation. We would like to point out that for every dollar of general funds the school public lands receive, we have returned over $20 to the state's public education and university system for over the last 4 years. Thank you very much for your time and attention this morning. Any more questions?
Thank you. Are there questions? Representative Carr.
Yeah, I'll take a stab at it. You know, last year we talked a little bit about when it came to mining. I think one area that I was a little surprised we got into was Bitcoin mining. And I think if I remember correctly, it's using the gas to run these computers to do Bitcoin mining. And with cyber or crypto coin, I guess, becoming more and more popular, I'm wondering if we're seeing growth in that area or any type of status update.
Well, first of all, Madam Chair, I know that Senator Maher is the one who really shone a light on that a few years ago as it related to some uncapped wells that had been abandoned up in his neck of the woods. I haven't heard of any new endeavors or increased focus on that. Are you familiar?
So that was a question I was going to have you, and I realize you guys are new to this, but the last report I got on Hardin County is that they're called spyglass wells because they're the ones who leased them, and then they went broke and bankrupt, and they had all those abandoned wells up there. Well, then through the conversations with Hardin County, Spygas just changed their name and started leasing those wells again. But Hardin County still hasn't been paid for the property taxes on those wells. I don't know where the capping is. We authorized $800,000 to cap them. I don't know where that ever ended up. They capped a few of them, but they never capped all of them. And last I knew, Bruner had put out some, they were trying to release those wells. I don't know what the status is on any of that mess up there.
We'll call on Mr. Corneliuson again.
They're going to use that to burn those computers.
Mike Corneliuson, land agent, School and Public Lands. Okay, so the Bitcoin deal is kind of having its rough days right now. However, there is interest in some of those spyglass wells for LP or liquid propane production. We'll see if that works out. The county, I've been in meetings with the county and former Commissioner Bruner, and they did hope to get money from for wells if they come back on production for money they figure that's owed from spyglass. So that is a part of the conversation. The way I understand it is that half of the wells have been plugged by the efforts of DANR now. I think it was actually under DENR when some of it was going on. So half of the wells, I think, have been plugged with the funds. But, I mean, without them having some kind of activity or being in a condition that they can be revived or brought around, they'll have to be plugged eventually.
So then that leads to the question. We have a state statute out there that says that when a well is no longer in production for X amount of time, they've got to be plugged. And so then that's all these questions are going to go back to Mike Lees and DNNR.
And that is my question. You understand that. So I'm asking either you or the commissioner, who has the authority here that can provide us an accurate update and what the plan is and what has been done? I appreciate the information, but who is in charge of this?
Well, the plugging falls to DANR now, or was DNR, but, I mean, that still goes to them. And they actually also are our partner in almost all of the oil and gas activities because they're monitoring it. We have some involvement with surface damage and in the actual leasing and getting the payments and stuff. But if it's not for DANR, they're the ones that are doing the inspections. They're the ones that are doing, they'd have to do the plugging. They make the determinations. So we partner on it in a sense.
Great. Thank you for that piece. Whatever staffer has DANR, please ask them to prepare a report on these wells when they come to do their budget. Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. A follow-up to Representative Carr's question. It might be actually directed to Representative Carr, but can you explain this Bitcoin mining scheme? And
well, the way I understood it is that they were leasing some of these gas mines, and they were using that gas to run the generators, to run the computers, to mine Bitcoin. So it's a different type of mining, but it came up in the conversation last year that they were starting to do this, and I don't know exactly what it looks like, but you'll see like big containers or big buildings, if you will, out on the prairie, and they're using the gas to generate electricity to run huge computers. So, and it was kind of new, and I'm just wondering, where that's gone since we see more and more cryptocurrency conversations. So.
Senator Colbeck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I don't know where to direct this question to, but I'm under the understanding that a company has purchased some of those wells, the ones that are operative, and then you've talked about this liquefied natural gas, that they've got a project going where they can liquefy this natural gas and haul it to their production facility and return it back into the original form of natural gas. Now, and I know the people that are involved in that, and they have also told me that they have actually delivered checks to take care of these wells and the leases or whatever it may be as of December 31st. Is there anybody in the department that knows anything about that? Or thank you.
So what we're talking, Mike Cornelison, land agent, School and Public Lands, but we're talking about our oil and gas assignments. Now, I don't handle that, Trayton Cost. Elmer handles assignments, and he can go through that with you way better than I can. But I did sign that we'd receive the checks, and if everything goes through, we would cash the checks and apply them, to keep those wells live. And if they can move into it with this LP. And these are the same sites as, or at least a couple of the sites are the same sites identified as the Bitcoin. And that's the reason they come about is because the Bitcoin deal has fallen on hard times. Otherwise, I think they'd still be holding on to it. Now, as far as Harding County goes, they will still want to receive back payments for taxes in the case of the wells they're working with. I suppose they'd like to get the payments on all money that might be owed them from Spyglass, but in the case that there's wells that would still be kept online, I think those in particular they'd be very interested in. But I can't speak actually for Harding County. But.
Yep, thank you, Madam Chair. Just a quick follow-up, I guess, with that, too, is that the company that has said that they have done this with the checks and everything else like that, that they were also working 2 years ago to get those wells and do what they want to do. And then you guys had to put them up for public auction at that time, if I remember correctly?
That is right.
And then this Bitcoin operator from whatever state they're from, they came in and without knowing, because we thought we had this thing all kind of worked out, and then this company Galston showed up when the auction took place and ended up outbidding the company that is now wanting to do what they want to do. So it's kind of come full circle.
In a sense.
Yes, yes, right?
But
okay.
there is an option in the case of these. Two, they can still be live. They can step into the old lease. It's through an assignment. They don't have to go to auction then. And I think they're willing to do that. But, I mean, I can't address, you know, that has to be the approval of the commissioner. And that has to be looked at by our oil and gas people. The commissioner, the deputy commissioner, and the oil and gas agent, they'll look at that. And they'll probably, no doubt, consult with DANR, see if there's any other problems there. And then they'll move ahead with that. But we did receive the funds. They're sitting there. We haven't done nothing with them.
Just one quick follow-up. I think it would be beneficial not only for your department, but I think beneficial for this committee and also the people in Harding County and the state of South Dakota to know exactly how that's all coming about. And so you say this person's involved or this group's involved. If there's some way we could get some kind of a summary, a general observation of exactly what's happening, because before we move forward with any type of, you know, action from this committee, whatsoever. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Carr.
Thank you. Commissioner Greenfield. Last year, School of Public Lands was working on a new website. They were enhancing their website. In that way, they could receive payments, new title services, and the old website, I understand, was just kind of like a business card, if you will. So it's supposed to be more interactive and mobile. And again, a lot of those services could be done through the website. Do you know how many visitors to that site you've had?
I do not.
I am curious, though. How is the new site going? Are people interacting through it? And are you receiving payment? And the services that you had anticipated, or the office had anticipated, is it going smoothly?
It hasn't gone extremely smoothly. Up until December 1st of this year, we didn't have a live system to receive payments for the lease payments or the renewals. However, BIT did correct that, so we can receive payments as of January 1st, and we've notified, it's on our website, that we can receive e-checks or a credit card payment.
Got it.
Yep.
Follow-up question for next year.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
You were more on top of that issue than I was, Mr. Chair. Right on.
Well, I have a question, Commissioner. So yep. Is someone going to follow up to what Senator Kolbeck was asking for, and who has the accountability to do that?
Yeah, we'll do that. And we'll work within our office to get some answers to those questions. I think as I was going over some of the materials, I think that if for example, has remained inoperable for 5 years, that's the point at which it's been declared abandoned. But we'll take a look at all things relative to the wells up there in Harding County that a number of us went up and actually visited, 4 years ago. Ultimately, the answer to your question is it falls on me, but I'm going to make sure that within the office we get you answers. And I want to just state, as a number of these issues have been fleshed out here, ultimately it's our responsibility to be the best stewards of the state's resources as possible. That's why, you know, as I talked about Wagner, I talked about some of the issues. Just a cursory walk around that dam shows all sorts of fractures within the dam structure and what have you. I didn't mention that, but I'm sure that the dam was squealing underneath my feet as I was walking across it. And I think it's important that, you know, our office gets out there and sees some of these structures and talks about what our options are going forward. If it's something that, as Senator Boland said, should be abandoned, if it's something that should be fixed, repaired for the purposes that, you know, the communities have come to know those structures, the benefit that they serve. I don't think anybody here who knows me thinks that I'm going to be one who's going to spend money unwisely. I do think, having been there to Wagner, they had a contingent of people. It's an important issue down there, and that's why I did want to highlight that. Very important to their community. And as I think Mike said, they're looking at wanting to have some skin in the game. So I'm kind of bouncing around from gas wells to dams, but we have a lot of important projects. You know, one of the things that was mentioned, but not at length, was the focus on weed and pest efforts, mitigation. And that, too, is something that I'm going to try to take a deeper dive into. We don't want, you know, I was down, actually, Senator Hunhoff, a little bit east of you. I guess it'd be Representative Kasten's district. And I heard about some concerns, and the concern ultimately was who owns the railroad and who's in charge of weed control efforts down there. Well, I learned that it's no longer under the state's purview. But there were some private landowners who were very concerned about the weeds that had sprung up in the railroad trestle, and how those were beginning to encroach upon private, not beginning to, they were encroaching on private grounds. And we don't want to see that relative to any of our assets under our office. So we're going to do our level best going forward to, and I do think that former commissioners have done a good job, but you can't be all things to all people. Some of these things that people have kind of spotlighted for me, I'm going to try to follow up on and make sure that we get good results and that we have good public relations with people. I don't want to just be that guy that says, oh, your concern is noted, and then put it on the back burner.
Well, Senator Maher.
So through the wonders of the internet, the Hardin County auditor has been emailing me, and she says, Ryan, I just want you to know that I'm listening, and I will get you all the info today. Please do not allow them to reassign these leases until we get our back taxes paid.
Thank you for sharing that.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Representative Carr?
Just a quick comment before we, everything we're about wrapped up. Thank you. Well, I just want to say to Commissioner Greenfield, you know, the last couple of years, I've always appreciated Commissioner Bruner, and we always joked that I felt like he knew every fence line and every rock pile on each of these properties that he manages and oversees. And I think if there's anybody that would take as studious an approach to that job, I think the right man is in that position, and look forward to working with you over the next couple of years and to following up with you on some of these issues.
Madam Chair, thank you, Representative. I appreciate that vote of confidence. I thought you were going to go down a different road, and I was going to say, I don't have any gifts to bring today, but former Commissioner Bruner was in his seventh year, I think, before he started coming bearing gifts of the million Zimbabwe dollars, which was the equivalent of about 40 cents in the original state map, which he said was about $3. I'll do a better job next year of providing something, maybe just donuts, but no, I do appreciate your comments. I thought you were going a different direction, but I am I'm one of those people who tries to pay attention to detail, and this is my job, and I want to be the best commissioner of school and public lands that I can possibly be. Thank you.
I have just one follow-up question. Last year, Madam Chair, the question is, last year we authorized your office one more FTE to the tune of $99,479. Has that position been filled?
The position will be filled next week. We have had discussions with an individual, and the intention is to actually have him begin working on Monday, which is Martin Luther King Day. So he's coming to town, and he'll be on board next week. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Commissioner, and your staff, and recognize this is your first time before us, and you did an excellent job, and you could provide the follow-up, and we'll hope things go well, and we'll see what follow-up is that you're going to provide us for the rest of this session.
I appreciate that. You're very generous in your compliments, but yeah, we'll follow up, and we'll be at your disposal if there are any follow-ups coming from you.
Great. Thank you. Thank you so very much.
You bet.
With that, we are going to conclude today at 11. PUC is next. If you need 5 minutes, that's it. We'll start in 5 minutes. So.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net.
Okay, we're going to come back. Our next agency is the Public Utilities Commission. We welcome you here with the new chairperson now before us. So welcome, and always please identify yourself each time you speak.
Thank you, Madam Chairman and Co-Chairman Derby and Appropriations members, Christy Fegan with the Public Utilities Commission. And I'm going to try to be as brief as I can today for you. I know you're trying to make up some time. I know there's some new legislators here, so I just want to tell you a little bit about this budget center because we get a lot of confusion and questions about it. It's a Public Utilities Commission budget center, but it has two different state type of organizations in it. One is the Public Utilities Commission that it has the authority from the three commissioners, and we oversee that budget. The other item that you see is the One Call Board. The One Call Board is a board appointed by the executive branch. The governor makes those appointments. That board has the authority over One Call and that budget. The Public Utilities Commission has no authority over One Call, and I've been getting a lot of questions, especially from new legislators, so I wanted to make sure you understood that. So the first organization you're going to hear about is from your three elected officials. And so there are three of us. We rotate on six-year terms, and I happen to be the chairperson at this time. So you guys have asked us, your legislative staff have asked us questions to present. So one of them is on staffing. We have about 31 FTEs. We've had about one FTE opening throughout the years. And so that continues to be a flux there. Also, we have one retirement coming up in June, which is very sad because our attorney for the commission has been with us over 24 years and she is retiring. So that is coming up. Staff retention, that is something we have worked very, very hard on since I've came to the commission. And just a great statistic, we've had about 60% of our staff that have now 10 years of experience. So we're excited about that. Retention is very concerning to us because our jobs are very technical and take a long time to learn before you're good at it and good at protecting our citizens. We do have two openings, and as you know, one of them's an attorney, and then one of them's an administrative. You've asked us if we have overtime. We have no overtime. As you know, your three commissioners are very conservative and protect overtime. Just for the new commissioners, or the new, well, commissioners or legislators, I guess, you could be a commissioner. We regulate grain, telecommunications. We spend a lot of time on energy utilities, and you know that we rate regulate six electric, three natural gas, investor-owned utilities. We are in the siting business, and you see us in the news probably every day on that. Regional transmission organizations are taking an incredible amount of time, and that's where I spend a lot of my time. In fact, I'm chairing a meeting today on the regional transmissions organization, and then pipeline safety and consumers assistance. Just our challenges. You asked us for our challenges. The rising cost of filing fees, especially for siting, is a challenge. Gross receipts tax, that balance goes ups and down. When I looked at the telecom tax on gross receipts from 2015 to 2021, we had a 28% decrease. Everybody knows landlines, phones are going down, but that's a big impact on our budget. So that kind of fluctuates a lot. We picked up a little bit during natural gas spikes, so we received a little bit more money last year. We have seven people that can retire and one is retiring. That can impact our budget. It's about $232,000 that can impact our budget any day, and we don't know that. So that's always the case. And then unknown docket load. That's always interesting because we never know what's going to be in front of us, and we have chargeback dockets. And this is our piece of legislation that we'll be bringing on chargeback dockets. As you know, our siting dockets are getting very complex, and our staff are parties in the case. Those are the people I cannot talk to because of ex parte, but they have to present in front of the commission evidence and facts and hire experts. And experts are getting very costly, so we'll have a chargeback docket. And as you know, we are not asking for additional changes or any changes. 84% of our money comes from other funds, about 11% from general funds, and 5% from federal funds. So with that, 4 minutes and 38 seconds, Madam Chairman, are there any questions of the Public Utilities Commission?
Right now, Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Welcome, Madam Chair Feagin. What are the other funds? How are those generated?
The other funds are your gross receipts tax and also licensing fees. So we have the ability to charge taxes on revenue from our utilities that we regulate, your XL Energy, Black Hills Energy, et cetera, and then telecom. So telecom, we also tax them like Verizon, Golden West, et cetera, on their revenues. And also grain does inspections and et cetera. Good question. And then, of course, chargeback dockets. So we will, when we spend money on an expert or our staff spend money on an XL rate case or Mid-American rate case that we're in right now, or a carbon pipeline, when our staff and experts spend money, that is a chargeback docket that comes back to us.
Senator Bolin.
Thank you. My question relates to, for instance, the bill I got from Excel this last month, how you have not approved the rate increase yet, but yet we're still paying in advance, and how has that all worked, and how would that, I just like to know how that all works and how you manage all that. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Senator Bolin, Christy Feagin with the Public Utilities Commission. As you know, we have to do everything at the PUC according to state law and what the legislature passes. So you guys give us a 1 year to work on a rate case. Then you give us the ability to stop the request of the rate case for 180 days. And that 180 days is up for XL Energy. So now they have the ability, according to state law, to put in an interim rate case, which they did. And then if we do not approve that level or it's less, our consumers will get that money back plus interest. So it's all according to state law. And as you know, your three commissioners try to adhere to that law every day.
Just follow. So there's nothing necessarily special about 180 days. It could be changed to 270 days if that was the purview of the legislature.
Okay. State legislature makes those decisions. Madam Chairman, Christy Feagin with the Public Utilities Commission, yes.
Just one other question. And do you know how long ago those standards were set? Any idea?
I would have to get back to you and look at that in state law. It was before I came to the commission. Okay. Thank you. We can get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioner Fegan, would you say District 11 is your favorite district?
I just want you to know, Madam Chairman.
Point of order.
Representative Carr, actually, I had number 11 as a license plate this weekend. That's how special District 11 is at the inaugural ball.
Any other questions? All right, then next. Good morning and welcome.
Morning. Thank you. Good morning, committee members. My name is Cody Gregg. I am the executive director of South Dakota 811. With me, I have Faye Jandrew. He is our board chairman at this time. I also have Kelly Iverson with Take Charge Bookkeeping. She is our accountant. And I also have Brett Kennecke with May Adam. He is our attorney for the OneCo Board of Directors. This morning in our presentation, I have information regarding South Dakota 811, our purpose, our board members, board policies, and then also moving into our financial or our board, our budget analyst that has been submitted. So some basic information regarding our board of directors. We have 11 board members that are appointed through the governor's office. The board members on our staff, our volunteer board members, 9 of them represent the utilities that are buried in the ground. We have 2 excavators on our board to equal out the representation of, again, the utilities and the excavators. Each board member, if they travel for board purposes, are reimbursed through the current per diem that is set up in the state. Again, Mr. Faye Jander is our chairman. Mark Meyer is our vice chairman, and he is with Watertown Municipal Utilities. To cover our mission statement, the purpose of South Dakota One Call Notification Board is to prevent damage to underground facilities, promote public safety through public awareness, education, and a cost-effective and efficient, dependable One Call service. We were established in 1993. Under the state statutes of 49.7A. Those statutes, again, administer everything that the board does and how we proceed. More information regarding One Call. Our purpose is we take the requests for locates. We are the center that is notified of excavation happening in the state. The excavator is given a free phone call to 811 that allows them, again, to notify the utilities excavation is occurring around the utilities, and that gives the utility a chance to go out and mark with paint and flags where those utilities are so the excavator does not dig into them. We have two main ways that locates are received right now. One is to call the 811 number, which is, again, a free phone number. 811 in any state will get you to that state's One Call Center. We also have an online portal that is maintained through our One Call Center based in Dallas, Texas. That online portal allows excavators to submit their work, map out their work area, and receive a locate request back immediately stating what utilities are in their dig zones. That also gives them the start time for their locate tickets, which is a 48-hour response time for the utilities. Excavation can start after that 48 hours has been met. So for funding, the first item I want to address is that there are no general funds used in the operation of South Dakota One Call. We are completely self-funded. How that occurs is when we are notified of excavation occurring. The utilities or the operators that have a utility in that dig zone are charged $1.05 for every time that they are contacted regarding excavation work. Again, that is our main source of funding. That rate has remained the same since 1998. A second source of funding that we have is through the complaint process, which is hosted by South Dakota One Call. If a excavator or a utility are found to be in violation of South Dakota One Call laws under that 49.7A section, We have the authority to impose a penalty of up to $5,000 for the first offense. Those funds are only collected when a complaint is brought to us by another party. Additional information regarding our complaint history. In 2022, we had 16 complaints filed with us. One complaint we have not heard yet, that is on our docket for February. We had 9 complaints that were dismissed through our enforcement panel for two reasons mainly. One or two of the complaints were brought to us 90 days past the date of the damage being identified. So after that time, we are not able to hear the complaint. Unfortunately, that leads to a dismissal. Seven other remaining complaints, the board chose to dismiss because the violation was not identified by the complainant. As the board is not able to investigate a complaint, we cannot assign a violation that has to be specified by the person filing the complaint. So that was the majority of the dismissals for us for this year. Altogether, we have six complaints that were penalized, $4,000 in total. We offer a lot of education opportunities through the complaint process as well. The complaint process is not meant to break down a company, it is meant to identify an object or an area of improvement. So again, with the enforcement policies, we offer a couple of education opportunities, including attending a damage prevention meeting, which we host in the spring. A better understanding of one-call laws done in-house by the alleged violator. That gives them the opportunity to meet with the person that filed the complaint. Again, as a face-to-face, this is what happened. How do we work through this and continue on with a good working relationship? Moving into our operating expenditures. The board of directors is looking at moving to an FTE status. So how this was addressed with the board of directors is we have the opportunity to move away from the independent contractors, which is currently in place and has been in place since 1993, to move those, the executive director position and the executive assistant position, to an FTE status, which more closely relates to the work that those two positions do. They follow more closely of an employee relationship rather than an independent contractor. In the budget that you have proposed or you have in front of you, we moved the $250,000 expenditure from the management consultants to the FTE budgeted line item. The budgeted travel remained at the same dollar amount, but recognizing we had the FTE breakout, we also broke out the travel for non-employee and FTE travel into that same amount, keeping the same dollar amount. And in the further down into our budget, management consultants was zeroed out again because that dollar amount was moved. Some additional operating expenses authority. iPads, we have an additional $1,000 requested for iPad purchases. The board members have access to a program that we call, or a board portal that we use called Board Effect. Board Effect houses all of our documentation, our scheduling, minutes, agendas, anything board related is stored in Board Effect, and that gives our board members an avenue to access everything 811. So again, we do provide an iPad to every new board member when they are assigned. It is not an annual purchase, it's only as needed. We do have a couple of board members that are looking to retire. So I know we do have board member purchases or iPad purchases that we will need to be completing in the next couple of years. An additional $1,500 was added for dues and memberships. As everything is currently, we are seeing some price increases in our membership fees, including the Associated General Contractors of America, South Dakota Rural Electric and Rural Water Associations, and also with our board portal, that price increases annually. We did adjust our legal document fees. Again, in the complaint process, when there is a non-response from a defendant or from a respondent, we do, under South Dakota state law, have the authority to pursue collection activity. That's not a step we take very often, so we did reduce that line item. Computer services, this is not a specific or identified budget amount, so we added an additional $100 to that line item just to make sure we do not go over budget. Continuing, advertising, South Dakota 811 is very much interested in educating the constituents of South Dakota of our program, our purpose, why we do this, what happens when you don't follow these rules. So we look to we look at ways to promote the 811 message. An additional $6,000 is being requested for the 2024 fiscal year. We do have a billboard campaign that is looking to start in the spring. That is an additional expense that we had budgeted for last year, but we are looking at continuing and increasing the amount of messages on billboard messages. We are also looking at radio ads and possibly TV ads. So again, that the authority being there gives us the opportunity to further increase our 811 message. For telecommunications, during COVID, prior to COVID, we were using the BIT telecom systems. With COVID occurring and everybody moving to a virtual platform, South Dakota 811 followed that same protocols and also moved to a Zoom platform. So all of our meetings now, if they are virtual or hybrid, are hosted over Zoom. An additional $4,500 was requested for authority in case the board requests an audit of financials. Again, this is completely at the board's discretion. The $7,500 total in the budget is a more realistic dollar amount if an audit is needed or if it's requested through the board. Lastly, to cover our One Call Center contract. When South Dakota was established in 1993, our One Call contract and services was defined under 49-7A-7. Again, that lined up or specified how our One Call Center would be run. The One Call Center, they receive locate requests. They control all of our mapping. They contact all of our utilities when excavation is happening. They maintain our customer base. Everything is handled through our center right now that is based in Dallas, Texas. That contract is set to expire on December 31st. So the board is looking to start an RFP process, again, to receive the services or the RFP responses to that contract. Again, looking to establish a new contract effective as of January 1. The center right now, Texas 811, has held pricing for us for 10 years. I don't anticipate that to be continued, honestly, with inflation and ticket prices changing, costs going up. I am anticipating an increase in our pricing with the center. We budgeted a $50,000 additional cost, again, not knowing if this is what our costs are going to be. So we did a rough estimate, I think right at 5% cost, a cost increase for a budget line item for the authority. One of the last items that we cleaned up was our supplies line, the 5205 section. We had some dollars or budget authority in the state office supplies, which we didn't utilize. So we removed that line item and added them to office supply purchases authority through the board of directors. I think that was the $200 cleanup. And then also reduced our postage. The postage amount requested was at $5,000. We reduced that to $2,500. The postage, how that comes into play is when a complaint is received, we have roughly 6 mailings that occur on every complaint that comes to our hands. So everything is sent through priority mail through the post office, which is roughly $10 per mailing. So roughly $60 to $70 per complaint. In postage, again, we did not reach that number, so we adjusted by what we were seeing in the financials. Lastly, I wanted to address our scholarship authority. We have we've been requesting a $20,000 expenditure to fund scholarships through the technical schools in South Dakota. We work directly with, the Build Dakota Scholarship to provide the scholarships in the state. We have three technical schools that we were able to offer scholarships to this year. I had set a goal for myself to offer 4 to 5 scholarships to those technical schools, and we were able to offer 13 scholarships this year. Again, 11 of them are heavy equipment operators through Lake Area Tech. We have 1 through Western Dakota Tech for construction technology, and we have 1 with Mitchell Tech that is studying Wi-Fi and broadband technologies. So we, all together in November, or excuse me, out of the $20,000, we have spent just under $15,000. We have roughly $6,000 available to offer upcoming students prior to the school year starting in 23. That completes my presentation, so I will open up for questions.
Questions? I don't know if I'm confused, but I had a letter and I wasn't sure. Was that you folks? All right, I asked that you provide a follow-up for us at this meeting, so are you prepared to do that and give an explanation?
Madam Chair, yes, I am.
Thank you.
Thank you. With South Dakota A11, we have an evaluation that occurs with the Pipeline Hazardous Materials Safety Administration. What that does is it reviews South Dakota 811 and pipeline safety. So it connects the enforcement policies that South Dakota 811 has in state law with the pipeline safety program that is run through public utilities. This year, South Dakota 811 was found inadequate through PHMSA regarding our enforcement policies. How that came to be is the pipeline safety program had recorded 518 damages to gas lines or to interstate pipelines. South Dakota 811 was made aware of 186. With the authority between the two, PHMSA had asked that a complaint be filed on every gas line damage that pipeline safety was made aware of. Understand that's only one entity out of the several that we serve. So if every utility with pipeline safety, if they were to have filed the 517 complaints with us, we would be completely overwhelmed. And again, focusing mainly on one entity in the ground. We worked with Commissioner Nelson regarding our response to that. South Dakota 811 does not have the authority to pursue a complaint. Under state law, we can hear the complaint, we can adjudicate the complaint, but we are not able to chase and charge the operators with filing that complaint. So in the meantime, we have taken a couple of other steps. I am working with pipeline safety to get a better understanding of the 517 damages, how many of them were a line break, how many had gas escaping, was it a scrape or a coating or nicking of the paint, the coating on the pipeline that was reported, trying to get a better understanding of what the damages were. Again, that is happening with pipeline safety and the 7 interstate companies. Well, last I had heard, the response that we had submitted through May Adam to Public Utilities Commission satisfied their request and their question as to what the process was and where we were. That's working together, forming a better communication or a better relationship between pipeline safety and our program. But at this time, there's not an additional step that South Dakota 811 can take to change the inadequate status other than further communication with pipeline safety. And again, to address the concern with the inadequate status, there is a possibility of a funding issue to pipeline safety. Pipeline safety, again, is a public fund, or excuse me, is a federal fund that helps to assist in the pipeline safety program. With South Dakota 811 being found inadequate, there again is that chance that the funding may be disrupted or may be lowered.
is the process that we have in the statute in South Dakota, is that similar to other states that have a system like we have a notification? Are they falling under the same challenges that our state fell under because our statute is what it is?
Thank you for the question, Madam Chair. I'm going to answer with, I can provide more information, but I don't believe so. South Dakota 811 is only one of two state agencies. All of the other state agencies are nonprofits. So I don't believe that that is, I'm not 100% positive on that response. I can definitely find out some more information.
Then this is a different bunny trail. Do you not have a statement that you put in the blue book regarding 811? Why don't they have a statement of in the blue book? Because I was looking and I couldn't find it. You didn't have one here.
I apologize. I'm lost on blue book.
What's it called? I can't think. I'm sorry, what? Yes, what's the statements in there called? Okay, but you don't have it in our binders.
Correct? No, this is in your binder. So this is the one called notification button.
Okay, I didn't find it. I'm sorry, I'm looking for something. I couldn't find it.
Absolutely.
Page 4.
Which page?
Okay.
You don't have, you have public utilities.
Scroll down to page 4.
I didn't scroll down. He's just got it under public utilities. It's just under there. I didn't scroll all the way. I was looking. There it is. Okay. Thank you. Because I was looking, you know, what your fund balance was. That's why I asked the question, but I didn't scroll down enough. I apologize.
No, ma'am, I appreciate the question.
Okay. Any other questions? Senator Boland.
question, going back to the slide about how you changed from the FTE situation around, do those, I guess my first question is, under the current situation, those management consultants or those people, they would not be state employees. Would that be accurate?
Madam Chair?
Or clarify that.
Sure. Currently, the independent contractors are not state employees. This is a procedure that we're looking at. As of right now, there's not been a lot of pathway designed for us to have this put into place. We have asked for the jobs to be classified through BHR. And also to work on setting up a pay grade. We have not received that information. So theoretically, this is a possibility. If this does not come to fruition, then we will continue to work through the independent contractors to make sure that 811 stays operational.
Okay. And just one follow-up. So currently, how many state employees are under 811?
Madam Chair, there are no state employees currently.
Okay, so then that brings me to my next question. If the proposed change goes through, then there will be state employees. And then my next question is, Chairman of the Retirement Law Committee, would you be eligible for state retirement? Would those new employees be eligible for state retirement?
Madam Chair, I'm not 100% sure how to answer that question. We would become state employees. From discussions that we have had, yes, all of these state benefits would be made available to those FTE positions.
Thank you very much.
Representative Duba, did you have a question?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Just a quick question on your scholarships. So are the funds that you're paying out now just for a semester, or are they for the full year?
Madam Chair, thank you. That $20,000 is what we have paid. That is for the year.
So you have approximately, what, $5,000-$6,000 left. So you could, follow up, Madam Chair. Go ahead. You could pay out for a semester, or would that go spring semester into the next fall? I'm just curious.
Madam Chair? Thank you. It depends on how the relationship works with the student and what works best through Build Dakota. If it works best to sponsor both spring and fall semesters and we have the funding, we would absolutely do that. Otherwise, we pursue them in the summer so we have a fall start for the scholarships.
Great. One more follow-up? Thank you. So obviously, these students are then obligated or tied to South Dakota. And they do they work in your program then, or how does that work?
Madam Chair, thank you. They do not. They continue to work with the sponsor that or the partner that is set up through Build Dakota.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm going to go back to the questions. What were the factors that were driving you to move from contract to employee status?
Madam Chair, thank you for the question. The discussion had come up with regarding the relationship between the work that was being performed between the independent contractor compared to an employee status. Understanding that the work that we were completing, working for directly for One Call Board of Directors, closely more followed the employee status rather than an independent contractor. That was a decision the board made to look at, was to move to the FTE status.
Just to follow up to that, so the Department of Labor bring that, or who brought that to your attention when you did the analysis?
Madam Chair, I am, I believe that was through Wage and Hour that was brought to May Adams' attention.
Any other questions? Representative Derby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Comment and a question. First of all, I've used this service. I'm sure there's many in the room that have used this service, and it's very efficient. It's a great service. Thank you. Thank you for all you do. And my understanding is you're a fairly independent, autonomous organization. And I can understand the history of why you're under the PUC control or in that department, so to speak. But it's really a kind of a public safety issue. Do you have any thoughts or concerns if, for example, we moved you to a different department, for example, the Department of Public Safety? Is that a thought or concern or issue to you?
Okay. Madam Chair, thank you for the question. There is no concern for us. We understand the relationship between public utilities. We match closely with several different departments, from anywhere from Department of Natural Resources, Department of Public Safety, Department of Transportation. There are several different areas that would closely fit to our relationship for the state agency. I have no concern as to where we land.
Okay. Follow up.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Commissioner Feagin, could you come forward, please? I'll ask you the same question. Commissioner Feagin, how would you feel if we move this to a different department?
Madam Chairman, Co-Chairman Derby, Christy Feagin with the Public Utilities Commission. As you know, it is kind of interesting and confusing for new legislators and the public because they think we have authority over One Call and we don't. So it'd probably be a cleaner fix, and people would probably understand that that is a governor appointee board, but totally up to the legislature.
Representative Van Huysen.
Commissioner Feagin, is that something that we could do in the budget, or would that require a statutory change to move it, or do you know offhand?
Madam Chairman, Representative Van Huysen and former Chief of Staff Van Huysen. You know, the commission has been asking probably ever since I've came to the commission, because it's a little bit odd. I don't want to speak on behalf of the budget and finance group, so we have asked for it before, but it just has never moved.
Yeah, Madam Chair. Go ahead. Yeah, not meant to be a hostile question. I think it's something that probably requires a bill to do. I don't think we can do it through the budget, and I just wondered if you had looked into that at all. if we wanted to do it, how we would do it. Thank you.
That's a good question. We can get back to you and look at that legal ramifications, and we'll get back to you on that. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
I have one more question. It has to do with the fund balance sheet. I get hung up on those. You know, for 2 years, you were running in the negative as far as net change, and then the last 2 years, you've had a significant improvement. What were the contributing factors? Because I'm trying to follow the lines.
Madam Chair, I appreciate the question. Let me find that. Again, this is Cody Gregg, Executive Director of South Dakota 811.
I see in contractual services you've had some changes too. You went up and then you went down. So if it's two people somewhere, there's been some, I don't know what your contracts are. So I'm just asking.
Absolutely. Again, thank you for the question. Under contractual services, there's actually several different contracts. There are the management consultants. There is the contract for our one call center and also for our accountant. We've also had a member retire. Larry James retired, so it's only been one independent contractor, so that has also caused or seen a decrease in the expenditures. Through the Texas 811 Center, we've also improved some practices that allow us to clean up our mapping, so we're not notifying as many utilities or operators of an excavation happening, so we're not invoicing as many dollars to operators that are not in that dig zone. So again, the changes to mapping and defining map areas is also seeing a less invoiced for contractual for our dollar amount through Texas 811.
Thank you. Any other questions? Representative Mills.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I believe I heard you say that most states are organized for this 811 function as a nonprofit, and that we were one of only two that do it this way. Can you give me a little background on why? Why did we choose this alternative, and is it still, in your view, the best alternative?
Madam Chair, thank you for the question. That is a very loaded question, and I do appreciate the thought that goes into that question. From my understanding, a state would move to a nonprofit organization for their own financial control. It gives them the opportunity to define their budget easier, I believe, was one of the main points of moving to a nonprofit. As for us, whether or not it would best serve South Dakota 811, again, there are pros and cons. I can see both ways having benefits. The way that we were established gives South Dakota 811 many, many resources to work with different agencies, and under a nonprofit status, I don't know that those relations would be as valued as they are right now.
Madam Chair, thank you, Madam Chair. I'm just curious if the fee structure then in those states where they're operating as a nonprofit, since they maybe have more autonomy, do they have higher fees in general than we do? Is that one of the benefits that we get in South Dakota by the way that we are organized?
Sure. Madam Chair, yes. So North Dakota actually charges $2.50 a ticket, and I believe Wyoming is at almost $3 a ticket, and they charge both excavator and utility for locating services, whereas our funds are directly correlated to the utilities, not the excavator. And we're at $1.05.
Okay, thank you. Anything else? If not, thank you so very much for the questions, and we appreciate, and thank you for the work you do.
Madam Chair, thank you very much.
All right. We are going to go into recess now, and we will reconvene after the State of the Judiciary. Thank you.
You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Follow us on Twitter at SDNet for announcements about what's coming up.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Follow us on Twitter at SDNet for announcements about what's coming up. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Download the SDNet app to your mobile device and listen wherever you are. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. You are listening to South Dakota Public Broadcasting's live webcast service on the South Dakota Network. More information at sd.net. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of SDPB. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the South Dakota Network, a service of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Links to live events and their archives are available at sd.net.